2,000 years after the departure of Jesus the Christ. The prophets are back to teach the real Jews, the 12 tribes of Israel, their true nationality. This is their campaign.
Israelites, the other nations were not included in this prophecy. It makes sense? If I talk to you, I'm not talking to the brother at the bus stop yet. I'm saying, bro, I have a question for you, I have a statement for you. You understand? Alright, so now same thing's happening to Moses. He's directing his conversation to somebody. Read.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 68. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
So bring the Israelites into Egypt. Give me bondage real quick. Because Egypt, in the Bible, is synonymous for bondage, synonymous for slavery. So God said, I'm going to bring you back to slavery, and then it gave a mode of transportation. Only one people went on that mode of transportation throughout world history. Read.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 5, and verse 6.
This is bondage.
I am the Lord thy God, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage.
So God brought us out of the house of bondage. Give me Deuteronomy 20:64. Now, I'm going through this just because I want you to understand slavery's in the Bible. God said I'm bringing the Israelites back to slavery with what mode of transportation? Started from the top.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, and verse 68. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
Now, what did the Bible say that these people are going to slavery on?
Ships.
Who are the only people in the world to ever go into slavery on ships? African Americans, who else? Hispanics. Columbus took the Hispanics, and the English, and the Dutch took them, and also the French took them into America as so-called blacks from the west coast of Africa. You understand? So only one nation of people has this history. So now, if only one nation of people has this history, blacks and Hispanics, who are they in the Bible? But who was the nation that Moses was speaking to?
Israel.
Now, understanding that, we need to understand what's so significant about this nation, Israel. Give me Deuteronomy 7 and 6. Watch. Because what I'm going to show you is, the Bible's describing us, blacks and Hispanics, you are the chosen people of God.
Right.
You are kings and queens of this earth.
Right.
But we fall into poverty and this state because we don't listen to God.
Right.
We are the most insubordinate and rebellious people on earth. But God has called us back to reclaim our heritage.
Right.
And we're going to show you what that heritage is. Read.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 7 and verse 6. For thou art an holy people.
So, bro, God says you brothers are holy. But guess what? Today, we are very unholy in the way we act.
Right.
So God is not going to reward your unholy actions with a holy favor.
Read. Right.
For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee.
So the special thing about the Israelites is that God chose them.
Right.
God
right.
chose Israel. So God chose y'all. God chose us. So now, if I ask you what your nationality is, what should you say? Now, my point was, this is a book about nationality. It's not a book about religion. So what did the Bible say your nationality was?
Bible says
Israelite.
Right.
Now you believe in the Bible then, right? Or no?
To a degree, yeah.
To a degree. You believe in the Bible? So what is our nationality?
Israel.
Right. What's your nationality? What would be your worldly nationality? Hispanic, black?
I'm Puerto Rican.
Okay. So what's your father?
Black and Puerto Rican.
So you're Israelite too, right? So now my point is, when we believe in the Bible, God says what our nationality is. Why are we going according to worldly nationalities?
Right.
God gave the final word. So yes, even though the world says you're black, African American, Puerto Rican, those are all names from slavery. So God's final word is, you're the chosen people of God, you're Israelites.
Right.
Now what's the importance of that? You have to come back and do something for God.
Right.
You understand? Now give me back, go back to Deuteronomy 10 and 12. Now we're going to go to New Testament. Right? Because I want to show you that Christ came only for us. This is going to be some hard. I know a lot of people like Christianity. A lot of people like that smooth words, right?
But God says he only came for one people.
Right.
Give me Deuteronomy 10 and 12. I'm going to show you something.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 10 and verse 12. And now Israel, what doth the Lord thy God require of thee?
And now Israel, all you blacks and Hispanics, Israelites, according to the Bible, what does God require of us? Because guess what? Most of our lives we never listened to God. So right. Now God's telling you something he requires of you to change.
Right. But to fear the Lord thy God.
We don't fear God. God says thou shalt not kill. We have the highest murder rate in our community.
Right. To walk in all his ways.
We say we love God, we want to walk like God, but nobody walks like Christ.
Right.
Christ is a black man, he would not be acting the way we act.
Right.
Right. And to love him. And to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul.
So we say we love God in the Christian church, but what does love really mean?
Right. To keep the commandments of the Lord.
So we got
to
keep the commandments. The reason we're in this state cursed is because we don't keep the commandments. So
right.
Now, I want to give you, brother, some commandments. Because it's good to hear we're chosen. Bro, I'm sure you know you're a king. I'm sure you're right, bro, right there with the chain. My man. With the hoodie. What's your name, my man? What's your name, my man? How you doing? Asen?
Asen.
Now, my question is, you seem like you know you're a king. You don't know, but we're going to show you. You're an Israelite according to the Bible. What would you say your nationality is in the world today? Would they call you Haitian, Jamaican, Black, Hispanic? Huh? You don't got a label, right? Okay, now I'm going to use this as a teaching moment. Where do we get these labels from? Slavery. Alright? So now keep listening. Now go to Matthew 15, 24. There it is.
The book of Matthew, chapter 15 and verse 24. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Now, who's talking here? Christ is talking. He said, I'm not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So even when you go to the New Testament, God only came for the Israelites.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Now watch. Get Matthew 2 and 1. Get that first. Now, this is a prophecy about when Christ came. What we're doing out here is I want to show you your Israelites and that the Bible's all written for you. Then I want to give you commandments because there's things we got to do, right? God said we got to keep his commandments. That's how we show him love. That's how we get out of this state. That's why we're so destroyed. That's why we have single-parent households. That's why we have drugs in the street. Because
right.
We don't keep God's commandments.
Right.
Wait. The book of Matthew, chapter 2 and verse 1. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. Verse 2, saying,
the king, governor of my people.
Verse 6, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the princes of Judah. For out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel.
So this is a prophecy about Christ. He was going to come to rule his people Israel. Does not say he was going to come and save the entire world.
Right.
He's going to be governor over his people Israel. So, knowing you're Israelites, because you are Israelite, you may not say you like labels, but God said when he created you, you're Israelite.
Right.
You're God's chosen people.
Right.
All right? So those labels, I agree with you. We shouldn't go by those. But we do have a biblical title. That's the kings of God, the Israelites.
Right.
All right? Now, what did God require of us to do? Remember the scripture? What did God say we had to do? What? You agree? He said keep the commandments. All right, so now let's get some commandments. All right, give me Leviticus 21, then give me 1 Corinthians 3:16. I have a commandment for all you brothers. Now, this is the moment right here where we decide and you see for yourself why we're in this state. God said we're in this state because of our disobedience.
Right.
So now I'm going to read a law, and you in your own spirit have to choose if you're going to be disobedient to God or obedient. I'm not going to say the law. I'm going to have the Bible read it. So this is where we're going to see for a fact if our people really want to change, if we're going to stay in this state. Read.
The book of Leviticus, chapter 21 and verse 5. They shall not make baldness upon their head.
So the Bible says the Israelites cannot bald their head. You cannot do a Charles Barkley, Michael Jordan. That's a sin. That's an Egyptian custom. Right? We were slaves in Egypt.
Read. Neither shall they shave off the corner of their beard.
So neither can we shave off the corner of our beard. That's why everybody that can grow a beard here has a beard. So if you can grow a beard, my man, you cannot shave it. That's a law of God. As simple as that might be, we got to do it. Because if we shave our beard, we're in sin. And that's why we keep it, we stay in the state. Excuse me, that's why we stay in the state. Now, that seems small, but guess what? If you can't stop shaving your beard, how are you going to stop doing drugs?
Right.
If you can't stop shaving your beard, how are you going to have a stable family?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Little things. If you can't do a little thing right, how can God trust you with a bigger task, like leading a nation?
Right.
How can you lead people if you can't lead yourself? You know what I'm saying? Now, this is not to get on y'all. You didn't know the commandments. Sis, I'm sure you didn't know the commandments until before today. Church don't teach this.
Right.
So I'm not getting on you. What I'm saying is now that you know, you're high to a higher responsibility from God. So that's beard. You understand that? Okay, so we can't do that. And I'm going to get to your point, because I know you said you believe in the Bible half and half. So I'm going to show you why you should believe it the whole way. Now, for you, my man, give me 1 Corinthians. This is for you. You have a beard. Maybe I can't use that for you, but there's something else you're doing. Wait.
The book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 3 and verse 16. Know ye not that you are the temple of God?
God says you are the temple of God. You know what I'm saying? God, when we had a temple in Jerusalem, not anybody could just go in the temple. If you were unclean, you could not touch anything. So God says now today we are the temple, because we don't have the temple today. We're in slavery. Wait.
Bring it up.
And that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you?
God's Spirit dwells in you, black and Hispanic man.
Right.
God's Spirit, that's a high duty of calling. God's Spirit, the Almighty, His Spirit dwells in you.
Wait. If any man defile the temple of God.
So now if any man defile his temple of God, what do you think that you do that defiles your temple?
Smoke.
Smoke, right? That's a hard habit to break. I'm not going to say it's not. But people in this congregation, people that we know, have quit that. You know what I'm saying? People used to smoke. All of us used to smoke something at once in our life, I'm sure. Now, that's your choice to change it or not. You know what I'm saying? You can't change it if you're around people that still smoke. Guess what? They're going to bump you a loosey. You know what I'm saying? You got to be around people that are trying to change.
Right.
So, you can't shave your beard, my man. You got to stop smoking. And it may be a hard thing, but you got to come around people. You got to come to the truth, bro. Because guess what? If you can't kick a habit of smoking, that means smoking rules your life.
Right.
And how are you going to rule over nations when you got a cigarette doing your every whim?
It
pushes you where you want to go. That's controlling your life. So you can't control nations until you can control yourself. You understand what I'm saying? So now, those two are laws. Now, since I got a law for you, you've been listening, so I'm going to include you, all right? You know what I'm saying? Now, Deuteronomy 22. Now, what I'm going to show you is, this is not hatred. People got it twisted. We're not out here to yell at y'all. We're out here to show y'all that we're going off.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? The reason that sometimes you may hear a voice raised is because our people are very rebellious. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes, as you see in our communities, you might have to, you know, get a little higher in volume to get it through our people's head. You understand what I'm saying? So, this is for you, sis. You didn't know it before today, but this is something you got to change. Because if people hate the way we live, poverty, single-parent households, drugs, go look down clean. You see people are passed out for heroin. People hate the way they live. Then we got to change as a people. Now, you can't say it's only me that's going to change and I don't have nobody next to me. You're looking at people that are changing. We keep the commandments.
Right.
We do the things that's required of us of God.
Right.
So you cannot say you're alone in this walk. No, that's your own mind. It's the devil in your mind. So now read that.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 22 and verse 5. The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man.
Uh-huh.
Neither shall a man put on a woman's garment.
So now sis, the Bible says a woman cannot wear that which pertains to men. What do you think women wear that pertain to men? Think about your grandmother. Our grandmothers used to not wear something that our sisters wear all the time now. Short dresses, yeah. Pants.
Bring it up.
Are you familiar with the feminist movement? That was when white women got our sisters into the feminist movement because of the problems they had in their white households. Now, Amelia Bloomer, I'm going to show you the history. Amelia Bloomer started Bloomers. Susan B. Anthony, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, after that, they started to wear pants to show as it was a statement that they're equal to their man. It was a statement because pants are manly gear. When you read the Bible too, it's Exodus 28, get me that real quick. So pants is something that men were given. Now sisters wear it. That's why sisters have a manly spirit. Because when you break the law, it's spiritual. You understand what I'm saying? So it is a sin. I'm going to show you real quick. This is what God gave men to wear. Three. Now remember, these are all commandments. There's more than just three. I'm showing you all these different things because we got to learn them all again. Church, you never heard these scriptures in church. No, I'm in the same body in church. So what's going on? They're deceiving us. The same way the image we explained earlier.
Right. Question. You say God didn't come for just us.
He came for just for us, yes.
So nobody outside of this can be saved.
And I'm going to get that in 1 second. Let me finish up here real quick and then we can bounce back. Read this real quick and then go to the New Testament. Read.
The book of Exodus, chapter 28, and verse 42. And thou shalt make them linen breeches to cover their nakedness.
So this is talking about the sons of Aaron. That's the priests, the men. What's a breech? What are breeches? When someone says pull up your breeches, what are we talking about? Talking about what? When someone says pull up your breeches, what are they talking about?
Excuse
me. Pants. So they made pants for the sons of Aaron. So God gave pants to the men. Now what happened was through the feminist movement, it switched. That's why you also see men wearing skirts and dresses nowadays. It's cross-dressing, it's against God's laws.
Right.
All right? So sis, as hard as it may sound, because it's America lets you do it, we got to change that. We got to change that thing. Women are not supposed to wear pants. They're supposed to wear modest clothes. Because think about it. When you wear tight pants, you're showing off your body to men. Men are now enticed and they're going to have sexual lust towards you. Now, that's how baby mamas come about. That's how broken houses come about. Because the men's looking at you for sex and not to marry you. Right. In the Bible, if you have sex with a woman, you got to marry that sister. Right. You got to take care of that child and that sister. Right. That's yours now. Understand? The Bible says that. That's why covering up and wearing modest dresses, it makes it signals to that brother that you're not about that. But our sisters have it flipped backwards. Now it's like, oh, I want to flaunt myself to get that man, and I don't care if he marries me or not. So that's why we have so much of that in our communities today. You understand what I'm saying? So it's all linking up to other things we got to do. Now give me Romans 11:26.
Finish 32 and 5.
Read that real quick and then jump to Romans 11.
The book of Deuteronomy chapter 22 and verse 5. The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. For all that do so are...
So all that do that thing, Nate,
are abomination unto the Lord thy God.
So God says whoever does that's an abomination. I didn't say it. That's why I'm telling y'all. We only read what the Bible says. We have been deceived and bamboozled so long that once somebody reads the Bible finally, now we think about, oh, it's hatred. No. We're only telling about what the Bible says.
And listen to this, sis, all right? Because it's not just for the sisters. Read that again, because now this new fashion that's going on now where brothers, the muscle-bound brothers, are wearing dresses and they're trying to pass it off as some new fashion. Right. Listen to what the scriptures say. Read that again.
The woman shall not wear
that which pertaineth unto a man. Uh-huh. Neither shall a man put on a woman's garment.
Neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. So it's not just the woman should not wear pants. The man should not be wearing dresses.
Right.
Okay, come on.
For all that do so are abomination unto the Lord thy God.
So the Bible says they're an abomination to the Lord thy God. Give me Sirach 15:13. Let's hear what the Most High God says about abomination. Because the bottom line is, if it's an abomination, that means the Most High God hates that thing.
Right.
Understand that. And that it's hard for sisters to believe that they're not supposed to wear pants. But do you know that, during, like he said, you go back in time, your grandmother and beyond that, you know, back in the 50s, 40s, 30s, none of our sisters wore pants then. Even going back to the time of slavery, they were in the fields with dresses on. Okay? Come on.
The book of Sirach, chapter 15 and verse 13. The Lord hateth all abomination, and they that fear God love it not.
So there it is. They that fear God will not love abomination. Give me Sirach 32:17. But this is the problem, though, because we don't fear God. We think that we good. We're going to do what we want to do. And, oh, God knows my heart. Okay? But the Most High God, he wants our obedience.
Right.
Understand that. Come on.
The book of Sirach, chapter 32 and verse 17. A sinful man will not be reproved.
So, it says, a sinful man or sinful woman, they will not be corrected. Like the officer brought out, you know, earlier about the beard. That's a correction, right? That you should not shave your beard. It's a law of God. You should not shave your head. That's a law of God. You should not wear pants. That's a law of God. But it says, a sinful man or woman will not be reproved. Come on.
A sinful man will not be reproved, but findeth an excuse according to his will.
What? Findeth what? Say it again.
But findeth an excuse according to his will.
According to our will, the will of the man, he's going to do what he want to do. And you know what that attitude is? Oh, God understands. He understands me. No, it don't work like that. You want to talk about inflexible? This Bible is inflexible when it comes to the laws of God.
Right.
That's why we are in the condition that we are in right now.
Right.
Because
right.
We chose to do what we want to do.
Right.
All right?
All right, give me Romans 11:26. Because the brother asked too, well, are we saying that now since we said that only Israel can be saved because Christ said that out of his mouth, is that really what the Bible's saying? Now I want to give you an answer. How you doing, bro? What's your name, my man? What's your name?
Deacon Gilly.
Deacon Gilly. All right. Now I'm going to read this for all y'all, including Deacon Gilly. Read. Now this is proving that the Bible is and Christ is only talking about the Israelites and to the Israelites, right? We're in the New Testament after Christ died, after the New Testament's already in effect. Read.
The book of Romans chapter 11 and verse 26.
Yeah.
And so all Israel shall be saved.
Who's going to be saved?
All Israel shall be saved.
Give me Revelations 21 and 12, the gates. So the Bible says only Israel's going to be saved. What happened was, when people talk about Jews and Gentiles and all these different things, they're forgetting the history about the kingdoms. They were split. So even in the New Testament, it's still talking to the nation of Israel, all right? Now I'm going to go to the end of the Bible, Revelations. Read.
The book of Revelation, chapter 21 and verse 12. And it had a wall great and high, and it had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and names written thereon.
So 12 gates are to the kingdom of heaven. There's 12 of them. Not one pearly gate, like the church says, not one pearly gate. There's 12 gates with names on them, right?
Which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel.
So who do you think is going through those gates? Every gate is owned by a tribe. The tribe's only going through that gate, all right?
Daniel of Israel United in Christ. Please subscribe to our YouTube channels. Stay up to date with our latest events, music, and classroom lessons. IUIC plans to continue visiting different countries where this gospel has not been preached before. IUIC needs your help in pushing this truth. So join us, subscribe to our Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and podcast, and stay up to date with us. For more information, please visit www.israelunite.org. Shalom, this is Bishop Nathaniel of Israel United in Christ. Please subscribe to our YouTube channels. Stay up to date with our latest events, music, and classroom lessons. IUIC plans to continue visiting different countries where this gospel has not been preached before. IUIC needs your help in pushing this truth. So join us. Subscribe to our Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and podcast, and stay up to date with us. For more information, please visit www.israelunite.org.